president of the Westmont College chapter of the Honor Society of Phi Kappa Phi. Welcome to the spring policy, well, Phi Kappa Phi lecture. We're very privileged to have here today two people, two former faculty members, who were the founding members of Phi Kappa Phi. One is the person for whom this lecture series is named, Paul Wilt. The other is a longstanding colleague of his in the English department, Paul, with the history department, John Sider. If the two of you would stand, we'd like to thank you for your involvement. I'd like to mention some students who are instrumental in the Honor Society Phi Kappa Phi, two of whom are the vice presidents that unfortunately can't be here because they are also on the national track competition that's taking place, Charlotte Combrink and Sheena Underhill. But it was announced in the installation banquet just last week that we would say who the new incoming student vice presidents are, and one of them is going to be introducing our respondents tonight. The first one, Winston G, who is a double major in chemistry and mathematics, unfortunately has to leave right after the main talk to be involved in a meeting for urban initiative, and that is Winston G. Winston, will you stand? Thank you. And then the second vice president, who is a double major in English and Spanish, Phoebe Wicks. At the end of this academic year, my term as president of Phi Kappa Phi will expire, and incoming president is Mark Nelson of the Philosophy Department, and incoming vice president is Helen Rhee of the Department of Religious Studies. So thank you in advance for the service that you will render. Tonight it's my privilege to be able to introduce Rick Poynter, and in thinking about how to do so, a remark that was recently made by the iconic statesman James Clyburn in the way he recommended Joe Biden for the recent South Carolina primary. I'd like to modify it just a bit. We know Rick Poynter, and Rick Poynter knows us. Indeed, he knows the Christian college scene, having begun his post-secondary education at Houghton College. After completing a PhD at Johns Hopkins University, and subsequent postdoctoral work at the University of Pennsylvania, he began his teaching career with one-year appointments at Oral Roberts University and Wheaton College. In 1983, he accepted a permanent position at Trinity College, and then in 1994, joined Westmont College faculty. So yes, Rick Poynter knows us. But he also knows us from a different perspective. That of an administrator. He willingly put on hold his Fletcher Jones endowed chair position for 3 years to serve as provost. In a recent faculty meeting, Gail Beebe expressed his great respect for the many contributions that Rick brought to the office. Thank you, Rick, for that service. But Rick Poynter also knows us. The U.S., us. He has written on a variety of articles with a rich diversity of topics, such as capitalism and the morality of economic success, freedom, truth, and American thought, and the Puritan Indian discourse in early New England. He has written two respected books on aspects of early America and is about to come out with a third, Pacifist Prophet Papenhoek and the Quest for Peace in Early America. From that book comes the title of tonight's lecture, Peace-Loving Indians? Recovering a Piece of Early American History. Recovering a Missing Piece of American History. I like to tell my advisees that if you leave this place without a sense of history, you're not liberally educated. So I invite you to take this opportunity to educate yourselves better by learning from a highly regarded historian. And I know you will enjoy the evening, not just because Professor Poynter, has received the Social Science Teacher of the Year Award 3 times. And not just because whenever he speaks, Professor Poynter displays a depth of wisdom. No, your enjoyment this evening is inevitable because Rick Poynter knows us.
Well, thank you, Dr. Howell. That was very kind. I do want to take a moment before I get started with the formal talk and just express my appreciation in a range of ways. First, actually, to Dr. Wilt here. One of the things that's been most delightful as I've spent my now 26 years at Westmont is the fact that there is great longevity in those of us who've taught American history here. Dr. Wilt taught it from 1958 to 1994, and I picked up the torch at that point. So I think if we do the math, that's something like 64, 62 years, and I think that's been certainly been a good thing for me. I want to tell just a really quick specific story about Dr. Wilt's kindness. So in 1981, I was finishing my dissertation and I was beginning to look for my first teaching job, I sent out about 50 letters to colleges around the country, most of them Christian colleges, just inquiring. It was harder to find out who had a job in those days available. And in those days, of course, there weren't photocopied letters. They all got typed by my dear wife, Barb. And most schools responded in a very form letter kind of way, but Dr. Wilt sent the kindest, most gracious response saying, "We don't have a job," which I heard a lot from. Actually, 100% of those letters came back that way. But it made me aware of Westmont. And little did I know that sometime in the future, we would have the opportunity to be here. And that kind of graciousness and kindness and generosity has marked Paul and his wife Doris's relationship with Westmont for more than half a century. So thank you, Paul, for your kindness, for your generosity to the history department, and it's wonderful to have you here this evening. You know, I also got thinking about the fact that when I came to interview in 1994 here, I did my job talk in this room. So that's typical, faculty come and do a talk. These days we tend to do them in classrooms, but just about the same time of year, 26 years ago, I did that talk. And the purpose, of course, was to get a job. I talked that evening about Indians, and here I am 26 years later also talking about Indians. I'm not sure what I'm trying out for tonight. I guess retirement or something. See if I qualify. But thank you all for coming. I realize on this Super Tuesday, there are other things that you could be doing. Obviously, you're all engaged in sort of biding your time to learn of the election results. Now, if you moan, you're just going to be stuck with more of these. That moaning is unwarranted. Enjoy it while it lasts, because that's all the entertainment for the rest of the evening. So, the talk is entitled "Peace-Loving Indians: Recovering a Missing Piece of American History." And if I turn my clicker on, we'll move forward. So, as Russ said, I have a book coming out in the fall, and tonight's talk is drawn from the research that actually began way back when I finished my other book, last book, in about 2008. And then things began to happen. First the Tea Fire, and I happened to lose a lot of research notes that night. And so I had to kind of restart things. And then the person to my left here asked me to be provost for a while. And so that kind of put a halt on things. And we've done a couple of Europe semesters in between, but eventually, slow learner that I am, I finally got around to finishing this thing. And the main things I want to try to do tonight, first of all, is I want to tell a story about a person The book is a biography, and so it's drawing on one person's life to try to illuminate some bigger things. So first of all, the title of the talk really has to do with the fact that I want to suggest that many of us continue to live with a kind of misimpression about American Indians. And we'll get to that in a little bit. Part of correcting that misimpression is trying to illustrate, to give you some examples of what here I'm calling Native or Indian peacemaking, peacekeeping strategies. And the main way to do that is through telling you the story of one American Indian leader who you've never heard of. Now, to say that you've never heard of an American Indian leader is probably not to really narrow the playing field all that much, because most any Indian that I might mention tonight, I'm guessing you won't have heard of. In fact, let's just do a little quiz here. So I want you to name, by name, an American Indian who lived before 1800. Let's see how well we can do it. Now, anybody from my current upper division class in early America should have a few more at their disposal, but let's just see who comes to mind as we get started tonight.
Pocahontas.
Pocahontas, all right. Was there one over here?
Powhatan.
Powhatan, good, because Russell's from Virginia and he knows that history really well, and I'm very proud of you. You just got an A here. But most of us have not heard of Powhatan, have we? No. Okay. He is the headman of Virginia tribes at the time that Jamestown is founded. Anyone else?
Samson Ophem.
Well, now see, Kaya, you're disqualified. All right. Otherwise, I'm going to have to start explaining who all these people are, and we'll never get to the story. Now, come on. Somebody from New England?
Squanto.
Squanto, thank you.
Massasoit.
Well, see, that's how you get to be provost as well. And he's written articles on the Pilgrims. So there's a few people in this room. But the average American pretty much knows two people, Pocahontas and Squanto. And guess what? They are about as atypical of Native persons in early America as we could come up with tonight. So if nothing else, I would like you for at least the next 48 hours to remember the person that I'm talking about tonight. Okay. Now, I said I want to tell a story. And of course, when you do this, you're telling a story that hopefully relates to some larger stories, some larger questions, some larger issues. And the larger issues tonight involve who and what gets included in our retelling, recovery, reciting of American history. That's why I say this is a missing piece. And it also speaks into our propensity to perpetuate incomplete and sometimes, dare I say, racist conceptions of Native peoples. The last few days, we've had some very profound and important conversations on campus connected to the Gady Institute Conference. And in some ways, you might see some of what I'm saying tonight as a PS for those of you who've been involved in that, to that story. All right, just a few other slides. Well, no, let me come back to this. No, I guess we're done with that one. Two other quick points before we go any further. So the name of this Indian gets rendered in Euro-American, that just means Europeans in the Americas, many, many different ways. So pretty much any way that I pronounce it tonight or that you would pronounce it, somebody pronounced it that way. I'm going to mostly say Pepunonk. We know from the Delaware Munsee language that he would have spoken that the main accent is on the second syllable. So just think papoose or something like that, Pepunonk. And the H is largely silent in the way that I'm going to do it, but you can see there's lots of different ways of doing this. His Christian name, Johannes, or John in the anglicized version, is given to him when he's baptized by a small German pietist group known as the Moravians in 1763. So he spends the last 12 years of his life as a Moravian Christian. He lived from about 1705 to 1775, and you can think of that final date as just when the American Revolution is beginning. Now, when you write a biography, typically it's the case that you'd have a lot of materials written by that person, and maybe you get to see things that they actually wrote. I know you can't really see this very well, but if I just use the laser pointer down here, someone has written his name, John Papunang, and in between the John and there is a symbol, and that's actually his clan symbol. There were three major clans within the Munsee tribe or people group that he was a part of. The Turkey clan that he was a member of, the Turtle clan, and the Wolf clan. You see that symbol on maybe two documents that I've found, and that is the only tangible piece or material object of any sort that I have from this individual. The only piece. So you might say, how in the world did you write 300 pages about him? Well, lots of people have been asking me that. Let's go ahead now and see where this takes us. Long before dawn on the morning of February 6, 1764, Philadelphia's bells sounded the alarm. For weeks, rumors had circulated that hundreds of disgruntled Pennsylvanians were on the march towards the city. Now they had reached its edge, poised to repeat the deadly violence waged upon unsuspecting Indians at Conestoga 6 weeks earlier. Citizens were summoned to the courthouse. Weapons and powder were distributed. Men were formed into companies and officers appointed for the common defense. Meanwhile, roughly 140 native persons, men, women, and children, the principal targets of the rebels' wrath, nervously paced within the British Army barracks, wondering if they'd ever see the sun rise again and praying for God's protection. Mohicans huddled alongside Delawares and Munsees waiting for the day to break. Most of those Indians were Moravian Christians, a German pietist movement whose missionary outreach to native persons had been unusually successful during the prior two decades. Johannes Papunang was one of its fruits. A relative newcomer to Moravian ranks, his baptism 8 months earlier provided him a Christian name and a new native community. In return, he brought his prophetic voice, diplomatic skills, and unflagging commitment to peace. A dramatic adult vision 15 years earlier had made him a determined pacifist. Many of the Indians who surrounded him and his family that night shared his love of peace. They were all in Philadelphia as war refugees, testaments to a world too often void of peace and a place for Indians like Papunang to call home. His life before and after the upheavals of early 1764 was a long quest for such a homeland. He wanted a space, however modest, in which the communities he formed and typically led could live independently and peaceably. That goal proved elusive for him and dozens of other native peoples in 18th century America. In that respect, his story was their story. They commonly struggled to maintain or regain a measure of autonomy amid a range of countervailing forces. Yet, Papunang did it his way, a decidedly peaceful way, and that set him apart from most, though not all, of his Indian counterparts. Faced with the onslaught of colonial peoples and pressures, scores of native leaders eventually led their communities into war. But contrary to long-standing popular impressions, some Indian headmen sought to resolve conflicts or at least to protect their own peoples through strictly peaceful means. Few did more or tried harder along those lines than Papunang. In so doing, he exemplified a heretofore largely overlooked Indian peacemaking tradition. Indian peacemaking. Was there such a thing? Were there such people? By the time of the American Revolution, fewer and fewer Euro-Americans were inclined to think so. They were convinced that all Native Americans were warlike and cruel. And what was needed was nothing less than the, quote, universal extirpation, that's just a fancy word for saying extermination, of all Indians from the face of the earth, unquote. 21st century attitudes towards indigenous peoples may fortunately be very different, but vestiges of those late 18th century notions have persisted. The impression in the popular mind tends to be, still, that Indians everywhere and always were warlike. Either by nature, cultural inclination, or political necessity, they had to be. As one historian has put it, war became so common in Indian country, wars against Indians such a recurrent feature of early American history, that it was easy to assume that Indians were warlike by nature and therefore merited treatment as savages. In other words, a type of essentialist view of Indians as a race of people predisposed to war and violence emerged in the 18th century and hardened in the 19th century. We no longer castigate natives in such derogatory terms, but the presumption persists that indigenous peoples were first and foremost warriors. Most of us continue to assume that all native groups were strongly inclined to resort sooner or later to violent conflict to protect their lives and livelihoods. But it turns out, key sentence here, it turns out that most native peoples across the long span of early American history, and that would be about 300 years, avoided war whenever they could. Instead, they more quietly pursued peaceful ways to cope with the new realities facing them after the Europeans' arrival. Unfortunately, that basic truth has largely eluded us. Tragically, in the long, painful history of Indian-white relations in America, the presence of Europeans and their weapons precipitated more violent and deadly warfare, and many indigenous peoples found it necessary to use force at various points to defend themselves or further their interests. Recent studies have made it clear that Pennsylvania Indians, where Papunuk spent most of his adult life, were no exception in the 1700s. After a generation or two of comparatively peaceful relations following the establishment of an English colony in the region in the early 1680s by Quakers led by William Penn, Indian circumstances grew increasingly dismal. Mutual accommodations and common ground dissipated as white population and territorial growth, imperial rivalry, racism, economic fraud, land speculation, and intercolonial competition impinged on native lands and sovereignty. Indian fortunes were so bleak that periodic resorts to war were seemingly inevitable. And yet not all Indians chose that path. Largely overlooked in this prevailing narrative are Indian individuals and communities for whom the way of war was no way at all. Are you good so far? Okay, that's the teacher in me. I mean, I got to check on my audience regularly. Okay. Even many scholars of early America have been guilty of perpetuating that violence-laden narrative. Accounts of Indian-European relations in the colonial era written during the 19th century and for much of the 20th century were preoccupied almost exclusively with violence and warfare. Somewhat greater balance has been achieved since the 1980s, but it's only been in the last decade that greater signs of hope have appeared. A few early American historians have begun to take more careful notice of Indian peace advocates and peacemaking efforts. Collectively, they are helping us to see, as one of them has put it, that peace, what it meant, how it was created, how it was maintained, played a central role in shaping colonial and imperial relations in the Americas from the first era of European exploration and conquest through the age of revolutions in the late 18th and early 19th centuries. Now, for the sake of time, I'm going to skip over a few examples that they've been pointing up, and you'll just have to take my word for it. I'll come to later examples. One of those involves the Chickasaw people in the Southeast. But together we can say, in these ways and others, you'll just go on faith here, friends. Large numbers of natives fought against war. When war couldn't be prevented, they worked to keep their own people safe and out of the fighting. They also worked to find means to end the fighting, design a newfound peace, and maintain it by not allowing new instances of violence to escalate. For his part, Papunuk developed a distinctive principle of pacifism that drew upon indigenous streams of peacecraft and other sources and became the driving force of his life and leadership. Few, if any, aspects of his final 25 years were not profoundly affected by it. Other native Moravians, who we see in this particular drawing, were pacifists, but none articulated that commitment so fully, so often, or so well. As he communicated his ideological pacifism in word and deed to natives and whites, he voiced an important element of 18th century Indian thought. Even that phrase might strike us as odd. Do we think about an American Indian intellectual tradition? There is such a thing. And it's about time we paid more attention to it. And he represented a prime example of the native peacemaking tradition. Reconstructing his story, then, provides a key opportunity to examine that tradition in a time and place of great testing. Like many of his native contemporaries, Papunuk yearned for his people to enjoy enough independence to live, work, and worship where and as they pleased. That's about as human impulse as we could identify. Unlike most of them, he wouldn't resort to armed conflict to gain those results and asserted a leadership committed to making peace the instrument of native well-being. That was an uphill battle, to say the least, in an early America fraught with bloody violence and racial hatred. But I think that's all the more reason to give someone like Papunuk his due. Giving him his due tonight entails sharing a few of the key dimensions of his life and work as reformer, prophet, preacher, diplomat, and community leader. His was a life marked by personal and corporate struggles, disappointments, tragedies, and loss. But that's not the whole story. It's also a life marked by courage, perseverance, survival, spiritual quest, religious faith, integrity, and a willingness to do the unexpected. So now let me just briefly summarize the narrative flow of his life. Born around 1705, the historical record is silent on his first 40 plus years. In other words, I know nothing about this person until he's about 45 years old. Now you could say, well, that makes it a whole lot easier. You can just make it up. Well, sort of what I've had to do. You fill in those gaps by talking more about his people and what's happening with them. And so here's a map. Again, you can't see it very well, but his people group were the Munsees. They're a small group that originates in New York. They move into New Jersey and Pennsylvania as they're being pushed out of New York. By the time we pick up where we have some documentation, he's probably living in this spot in Pennsylvania. It says Lackawanna. It's along the Lackawanna River, and then the larger river, the Susquehanna, is there. So basically northeastern Pennsylvania. So we have to paint his life in those early years, about two-thirds of his life, with broad strokes, situating him within his people's, that is the Munsee's, increasingly challenging world in Pennsylvania in the first half of the 18th century. Suffice it to say that their numbers, lands, and options were shrinking. Then in about 1750, the great turning point in his life came, an adult vision quest that brought a radical encounter with the supernatural and a newfound sense of purpose and vocation. He became a prophet, determined to fulfill the divine calling he received. Now, keep in mind, this is all pre-Christian moments for him, okay? Over the next decade and a half, he preached a peace and justice message in the midst of a world at war, gathered a substantial band of followers, and pursued a host of strategies to keep them alive and comparatively autonomous. When violent forces finally threatened to destroy them all, his company splintered. he and a small minority joined with fellow pacifists, Native and white Moravians, and sought protection in Philadelphia. That's where I started the story. Now I've gone back and I'm getting back to 1764. For 16 months, they suffered as war refugees, losing a third of their members to disease, even while narrowly escaping attack from white vigilantes, persuaded not to attack Philadelphia largely by Benjamin Franklin. Just to throw in a name you've heard of. During those difficult days, he became immersed in Moravian ways, grew in his Christian faith, and combined Christian elements more thoroughly into his Muncie identity. When finally released from the city, he led his new native community back to his former village along the north branch of the Susquehanna River in northern Pennsylvania. So even further up, it's a town called Wyalusing. Still there today. They have a big plaque saying, Wyalusing since 1752, friendly, historic, and something else. Problem is, the town actually didn't get founded till 1758. They've read the documents wrong, but who's going to change the sign? Probably not Poynter. Right. They spent 7 years there, mostly prospering as a Moravian town, but all the while struggling to secure a more permanent right to live in that place. By 1772, their fight had been lost, and the entire community was forced to move west to the Ohio country in search once more of a safe and peaceful homeland. Papunuk persevered 3 more years in that work and then died in May 1775, just as a whole new conflagration, the American War for Independence, was breaking out. He'd spent the last 3 decades of his life fighting his own native war for independence, not with guns or tomahawks, but with a powerful peace discourse. Through word and action, he showed Indians and whites alike what it meant to live upon the conviction that, quote, when God made men, he never intended they should kill and destroy one another. The era of the 7 Years' War, or as Americans like to call it, the French and Indian War, offers perhaps the best illustration of his peacemaking efforts, so I'll devote most of the rest of my time to it. Before I do, though, let me say a few words about the challenge of researching his life, or more than I've already mentioned. Most of what we can know about Papunuk comes, on the one hand, from government documents, such as minutes of treaty conferences, letters to and from political and military officials, legislative proceedings, and diplomatic dispatches. So there's that stuff on the one hand. And then the rest of it comes from religious sources, Quaker and Moravian letters like the one I've put up here, diaries, petitions, pamphlets, meeting minutes. As might be expected, such materials offer particularly good bases for tracking his political and diplomatic dealings, as well as his religious thought and practice. But thanks to the Moravian disciplines of having their congregations keep daily diaries and their missionaries write frequent letters, there's also much rich information about the practical realities of Papunuk's life from 1764 to 75. I'll just point out, again, it's really hard to see unless you're in the front row. Maybe you can see here the date. It says 1774, this letter. What you're not going to be able to read is much of the rest of this, not only because you're not very close to it, but because it's in German. And it's not only in German, but it's in 18th century German. And it's not only 18th century German, but it's 18th century German script. And there's only about 20 people, that's a bit of an exaggeration, but only about 20 people who can actually read this today. It's a very specialized kind of script. Poynter isn't one of them, and I was way too old when I started this, first to learn German, then to learn 18th century German, and then 18th century German script. So what do you do when you can't read it, but you want to? You get funding from the president and an endowed chair to pay for translators. And that's exactly how this project happened. It couldn't have happened any other way besides the Fletcher Jones money and other research funds. And so thanks to President Beebe and the foundation for underwriting all of that. Now, from these letters and other sources, we learn not only of his piety, but of his prowess as bear hunter and his frequent preference for being in the woods on the move rather than at home in his village. Others of us may prefer that as well. As rich as they are, though, the sources still leave us wishing for more. More about his personality, more about his interior spaces, much more about his earlier life. Just think how many more pages I could have written. The type of full-bodied biography possible for better known or more recent historical figures is simply not feasible in Papunin's case. So lots of people told me, give it up. Still, the available sources allow a portrait to be drawn that consists of more than a few impressionistic lines and shapes. The colors of his mind and personality, as well as the details of his political and religious maneuverings, at least for the final third of his life, can be filled in with reasonable confidence, and I would argue that even a partial life of people and voices who have been so long ignored is way better than no voice, no attempt. Here we have a person whose life has never been told. This was the biggest and most ambitious detective work I've ever done. It took me 10 or 11, 12 years, depending on how you count. It was fascinating, frustrating, and ultimately extraordinarily fulfilling. Regrettably, we can't fill in what he looked like physically with any specificity. So imagine spending 12 years thinking about somebody you have no idea what he looked like. Or no specific idea, anyway. No artistic portrayals of Papunin exist, at least none produced in his lifetime. Renditions of other area natives give hints of his possible appearance, as do snippets of written description scattered throughout the archival record. In particular, Gustavus Hesselius' portrait of Delaware Sachem Tishkahan from 1735 provides a starting point for conjuring an image of the Munsee reformer. The two men may have even known one another, since both operated in northeastern Pennsylvania. Hesselius depicted Tishkahan as a strongly built man, apparently fully capable of doing demanding physical labor well into his later years. More telling yet is the artist's effort to capture the sachem's serious and wearied countenance. Here, deep in thought and unadorned by any paint or tattoos, according to one European source, his very name meant he who never blackens himself. All of that fits well as a description of Papunin. He did the strenuous work of younger men right up until his death at age 70, and once he became a Moravian Christian, gave up wearing paint or other previous forms of adornment. Like Tishkahan, he wore nothing to hide the naked truth of life's toil. His face, old and worn, would have shown the stresses and strains of fighting against the destructive effects of colonialism for many decades. Each wrinkle and line bespoke the toll that alcoholism, war, disease, displacement, and death took upon him and so many other native persons. A century later, in 1862, Philadelphia painter Christian Schussel sought to capture the drama of Moravian missionary, I'll let you figure out who that happens to be, David Zeisberger's evangelism in the Pennsylvania interior in a portrait entitled Zeisberger Preaching to the Indians. It's also known as The Power of the Gospel. Schussel likely based his work on actual historical accounts of the action he sought to depict. Zeisberger's 1767 visit to Goshkeshunk, a multi-ethnic Indian town on the Allegheny River in western Pennsylvania, and therefore he knew to include Papunin in the picture. He was one of two native assistants who accompanied the missionary on the journey and played a crucial role in evangelizing Indians there. Most likely, Schussel depicted the two of them as seated on either side of Zeisberger. It's hard to see, but probably one there and possibly either this person or this person, but they're definitely the ones sitting at the right and left hand of Zeisberger. They listen with rapt attention and gaze upwards into the light illuminating Zeisberger's face and hands. But there's no hint here that they too will speak, which they in fact did at length. Nor are there many clues for 19th century viewers that Johannes and Anton, the two Christian natives, are already Christian believers. At best, they are bit players or worse, stage props, partially hidden in the shadows, cast in a drama in which they can do no more than kneel at the feet of its star and sit at the edge of its action. Unfortunately, this comes close to capturing metaphorically where Papunin remains within early American historical consciousness. This will not do. He's too important a figure to remain so obscure. His story is simply too interesting and dramatic not to be better known. Full of moments of spiritual awakening, violent conflict, political negotiation, moral condemnation, racial attack, wartime captivity, epidemic disease, witchcraft accusations, and overland journeys. What more do you want, friends, for a good story? Papunin's life offers a rich window into the predicaments and perseverance of Indians in 18th century America. They faced unprecedented pressures on their lands and sovereignty as white settlers pushed westward, imperial rivalries intensified, and the racial divide widened. Okay, let's get back to the Seven Years' War. So, hostilities commenced in the Ohio country, largely thanks to George Washington as a very young, inexperienced military officer, where tensions had been building for a decade as the two imperial powers, France and Great Britain, flexed their muscles in hopes of gaining dominance over that territory. Area Indians became increasingly caught in the middle. Their efforts to gain some advantage from the British-French rivalry proved largely futile. Once war began in the summer of 1754, almost all of them had to choose sides. Though by no means united in their choices, most, sooner or later, opted to support the French, at least to the extent of waging war on a common foe. By the fall of 1755, with French support and endorsement, Ohio, Delawares, and Shawnees were raiding homes, settlements, and forts along the Pennsylvania, Maryland, and Virginia frontiers. As one historian has graphically described it, the combination of French arms and the Delawares' and Shawnees' unerring knowledge of the landscape and population made these raids especially devastating. They mutilated their victims' bodies in pointedly symbolic ways, removing or defacing sexual organs to emasculate their enemies. In one community after another, raiders brought terror and death to the colony's exposed and largely undefended frontiers. With dozens and eventually hundreds of colonists being killed and even more being taken captive, Pennsylvania shuddered with fear. Indian raids were intended to provoke panic and to convince settlers to flee from their homes before it was too late. Whites and natives alike were in grave danger. Raids moved progressively eastward, threatening larger centers of settlement, generating streams of refugees, provoking increasingly strident calls for the colony's assembly to provide some protection for its citizens, and putting more and more pressure on Indians still living east of the Allegheny Mountains. The latter group included Papunuk and his village of between 100 and 200 followers. They were an easy target for a colonial government and population anxious to gain some measure of retaliation and revenge against any native peoples. A racial hatred and regional distrust that had been latent for seven decades was now ready to explode amid the upheavals of war, and exploded did. Pressed by both sides to join them, Papunuk opted instead to keep his people neutral while the outcome of the war was still very much in doubt between 1754 and 58. He was the first of his peacekeeping strategies, risky though it was. Neutrality aroused suspicions from both sides that such a policy was a mere ploy to cover up efforts to aid and abet the enemy. As one group of Wyoming Valley Indians put it, "We're in danger of being attacked on all sides by French and Native enemies who are much enraged. We are no less afraid of the white people who suspect us of having been accessory to the murders committed in various places. We are in danger of being murdered by the white people." With each new terrifying report of colonists slain or captured, white Pennsylvanians' rage grew, especially on the frontier. They increasingly hated the French and their native allies. We might expect that. But with few identifiable Indians on their side, sympathy evaporated for all natives. "The white people considered every Indian as an enemy," one Moravian wrote. "They were all deceitful. They were all appropriate targets for revenge." As frontier whites impatiently waited for the Pennsylvania Assembly and other provincial officials to authorize a militia and build forts for their defense, some were ready to take matters into their own hands, especially once many of their wives and children were secured in refugee towns farther east. The men of these families looked for opportunities to inflict retaliatory violence on Indian persons of whatever variety. The religious identities of natives made no difference. All that mattered was their race. Roaming mobs formed ready to, quote, justify an attack on any Indian as the necessary action of men defending their families and ways of life. By year's end, colonial Indian agent Conrad Weiser reported that a group of Paxton people took an enemy Indian and, after questioning him, shot him in the midst of them, scalped him, and threw his body into the river. Amid that kind of violence, Papunik knew that neutrality alone would not keep his followers safe or perhaps even alive. More blood was likely to flow in the Wyoming Valley. Claims to being friendly or peaceful Indians were not enough of a defense. At some point then, in late 1755 or early 1756, Papunik and his company got out. Their village near the mouth of the Lackawanna River at east central Pennsylvania was no longer viable. There were simply too many threats to their well-being to stay their ground. And Papunik had no interest in defending it if it meant using violence to meet violence. So they headed north, hoping to get out of harm's way. And they sought out a place near the Pennsylvania-New York border, set off from both hostile whites and other natives bent on warring. Papunik's strategies of political neutrality, geographic mobility, and communal isolation sought to protect his people amid the storms of war. They may be seen as pragmatic responses to the rapidly changing circumstances of Susquehanna Valley Indians. Yet something more than pragmatic strategy factored into their policy choices and community decisions. In the 1750s, if not before, he developed a deep philosophical commitment to peace and became a devoted pacifist. Later in the war, he came to side with the British, at least to the extent of aiding peace initiatives. He was willing to give up political neutrality when it no longer served his community's best interests, but he was never willing to give up his opposition to war and, more broadly, violence. He refused to condone war or to believe that violence was ever the appropriate means to resolve disputes. He didn't want his followers taking up the sword no matter what it might cost them. Testimony from a few years later indicates that they heeded his message and, quote, absolutely refused to join the other Indians in the prosecution of the war. When pressed by pro-French Munsees and Delawares to add to their ranks, they responded, quote, that they would not join them in it, though they should kill or make slaves, or, as they express it, Negroes of them. Apparently, they were ready to be enslaved or even die for the sake of their pacifist convictions. That level of commitment bespeaks the power of Papunik's pacifist preaching and teaching in the 1750s. Clearly, it was a key element of what drew some adherents to his message and his community. It's been told to my heart that man was not made for that end, therefore I have ceased from war, he said. However much he had engaged in the affairs of war before his enlightenment, he was done with it now, and he was prepared to suffer the consequences for his stance against violence. Quote, from the time God first showed himself to my mind and put his goodness in my heart, I found myself in such a temper that I thought if the flesh had been whipped off me with horse whips, I could have borne it without being angry at these that did it. Such words were not an idle boast. They were an expression of deeply he believed pacifism was a matter of moral right. Therefore, whatever argument might be advanced in defense of war, Papunik was unconvinced. He went on to chide himself for not doing more in the cause of peace in the months and years that went forward. He explained his moral failure as the product of an internal spiritual struggle. And here we hear echoes of Quaker influence, I think. I was made weak for that work by the bad spirit striving to overcome the good in my heart. But I hope the good spirit will overcome the bad, and then I shall be strong to labor heartily to bring people from war to peace. Peacekeeping and peacemaking were difficult calls to follow, even for him. Where did his call come from? Well, he always linked it back to his original vision, back to the, quote, time God first showed himself to my mind. Preaching peace was part of his, what he called, endeavoring to put in practice what he apprehended was required of him. Other Indians in this same era heard a different call. In fact, more than anything else, Papunak's pacifist stance set him apart from other Native American prophets of this and later generations. Arising out of the nativist impulse to reject all things European, by the early 1760s and off and on again into the early 19th century, militant pan-Indian alliances arose bent on reviving Native communities and pushing back Euro-American advances. Perhaps you've heard of Pontiac or later on Tecumseh, both inspired by prophets preaching a militant response to the Euro-American presence. Papunak could not countenance such a path. He simply wanted no part of war. His vision quest had answered that question. Even if it was a struggle to follow through on his peace work, he knew it was the right thing to do. It was a matter of moral duty, was in line with the traditions of some of his people, and drew upon wider Indian traditions of peacemaking. His actions on behalf of peace and in response to acts of violence, large and small, reflected his employment of well-established indigenous means of conflict resolution. And I think for the sake of time, I'll just let you see those. I illustrate those from the 17th and 18th century in other Native communities, but I think we'll move on from those. I'll leave that up for a moment. Indigenous sources of Papunak's dedication to peace were likely supplemented by Christian ones. That seems to have occurred as his contacts with Moravians and Quakers increased in the late 1750s. His pacifism didn't originate with them, but their peace witness reinforced his own and gave him potential allies in the quest to keep his community secure. Between 1758 and 1763, he pursued ever closer relationships with both Christian bodies as part of his own spiritual journey and in service to the wider cause of peace. In fact, in those years, I would argue, relationship building was at the heart of his efforts to maintain peace and security in a still fragile and unstable world. He shrewdly navigated relations with the dominant power brokers of the day, the Pennsylvania government, British imperial policymakers, the Iroquois Confederacy, powerful Quakers, and Ohio Indians. And he gained a hearing for his peace and justice message despite him and his community having little, if any, power themselves. Again, I'll abbreviate one section here that talks about his appearance in 1760 before the Pennsylvania governor and his council, where after negotiating other things, he says, well, there's just one more thing I want you to consider here. And then he goes on to challenge the way in which trade was being conducted. English traders announced one price for Indian-supplied skins and then paid another. God cannot be pleased, he said, to see the prices of one and the same thing so often altered and changed. In turn, Indian suppliers, faced with unreliable prices, resorted to practices that cheated their buyers, such as soaking their furs to add weight to them. Under these conditions, trade relations deteriorated to the point where there was, quote, no love nor honesty on either side. Gone were the days when economic exchanges were more than a transfer of goods. They had been occasions for mutual respect and dignity. Therefore, brother, he concluded, we propose to fling this entirely away, for if it remains, so we shall never agree and love one another as brothers do. By the time the Seven Years' War officially ended in 1763, Papunak could legitimately say that he had successfully navigated the community's relations with powers and events largely beyond their control. In that time, he had determined that more than ever their peace and security depended on building productive alliances. To that end, he had more fully engaged his people in the wider political, military, and diplomatic affairs of Pennsylvania and colonial America. Nothing in mid-1763 suggested that would not need to continue long into the future. On the contrary, another war, Pontiac's War, in which Western Indians once more rose up to contest British rule and encroaching colonial settlements, had already broken out. Over the course of the next dozen years, the last dozen of his life, Papunak carried on that work within the confines of his new community of Native Moravians and German missionaries. While the nature of his religious authority changed, his unflagging ideological commitment to pacifism and his undaunted pursuit of a peaceful and secure homeland for his people did not, even when it came at great personal risk. On one occasion, his efforts at mediation rewarded him with a tomahawk blow to the neck. At other moments, he was falsely accused of poisoning community members and practicing witchcraft. Nevertheless, he persisted. By 1772, that meant moving with all other, moving with all other Moravian Indians to what today is Eastern Ohio. But even there, their presence and safety were highly contested. Finally, in March 1775, peace had been restored following yet one more war, and Native Moravians had secured a substantial measure of autonomy, freedom, and respect. They had a homeland. How long it would last, no one knew. But surely they were entitled to a few innocent, even naive moments of imagining that here, finally, they had a peaceful place of their own to live out what they understood to be God's call upon them, and to pass on this space and this faith to their children and their children's children. No one had more of a right to entertain such thoughts than Johannes Papunang. His life's work, or at least the last 25 years of it, was choosing peace over war and leading communities dedicated to that principle. Their perennial struggle within the exigencies of mid-18th century early America was finding somewhere to call home. That was a quest shared with dozens of indigenous peoples. Some other native leaders, for practical reasons, similarly believed that peace was the best and only viable means for achieving that goal. But overall, relatively few Indians and even fewer Euro-Americans embraced the values, attitudes, lifestyles, and ideological pacifism Papunang cultivated first among his followers and then among fellow Moravians. They ran too much against the grain and were frankly just too hard. They allowed little room for self-aggrandizement, revenge, or hate. Those commodities were in ample supply within the Munsee Prophet's world, and as a result, all his efforts reaped merely modest gains against them. And they left his people, whoever composed that group at any particular moment, repeatedly searching for a secure space to stay. Like indigenous peoples across the continent, they wanted to retain or regain a measure of sovereignty, an element of independence. In the Ohio country in 1775, Papunang may have let himself believe that dream had finally been realized. If it was not quite the promised land, it was at least a place where war had ended, wider authorities had endorsed their right to be there, Moravian towns were growing, and some of their opposition was moving further away. Could he hope for much more than that? No wonder then that when he died 2 months later, his final words were that, quote, he loved everyone and did not hold anything against anyone. And here he is buried in Schoenbrunn, Ohio, or what was Schoenbrunn, Ohio. It's tempting to think that Papunang was unusual in facing so many momentous choices in the years from the Seven Years' War to the American Revolution. But in fact, those choices were common for Indians living across the continent during those tumultuous decades. Decisions had to be repeatedly made about where to live, how to hold on to homelands, whether to fight, where to find power, how to subsist, whose ways to follow, and how to be safe. Papunang was an ordinary Indian in having to confront those types of issues. Dozens of other native peoples and native leaders had to do the same as they encountered the challenges and opportunities, imperial contest, territorial expansion, and racial antipathy presented. On the other hand, he may rightly be seen as quite uncommon and extraordinary in the paths he chose. And in so doing, he frankly bewilders us. Like other native peacemakers, he fits poorly or not at all into the categories constructed for 18th century Indians or Indians in any era. A Delaware prophet who inspired peacemaking rather than war? A nativist willing to embrace Christianity and maintain that commitment till the end? An outspoken critic of white political and economic practices highly admired by leading white Pennsylvanians? a native war refugee protected by some whites against the violent intentions of other whites, an Indian whose life may be sufficiently reconstructed to write his biography. Then and now, Yohannes Papunang stands out as an extraordinary man, a countercultural individual whose story forces us to broaden our notions of whom and what Indians could be and do in early America. Whether in 1775 he had an inkling of a coming revolution and war for independence is impossible to know. For his kin and other native brethren, those developments meant reiterating their commitment to peace and political neutrality. It also meant abandoning their homes, being mistrusted by all parties, and being once again caught in the crossfires of early American violence. Their wholesale massacre in March 1782 in Gnadenhütten, Ohio, by colonial militia, seems an almost inevitable outcome of a generation of disturbing events. Among the victims that day were Papunek's son-in-law, a grandson, two of his granddaughters, and a great-granddaughter, bludgeoned, scalped, and burned with the rest of their village. It would be naive to imagine that Papunek, had he lived, could necessarily have done anything to prevent the tragic horrors that befell three generations of his offspring that bloody morning. Yet it's still worth pondering whether his diplomatic skills and love of peace might have made some type of difference, for it was precisely this eventuality that he labored so long and so hard to avoid. The dream of finding a secure homeland where he could live in peace with like-minded natives amid the turmoil and terrors of mid-18th century America animated the final 25 years of his life. In the end, the wonder is not that so many of his people were brutally murdered, but that largely through his courage, perseverance, wisdom, and vision, so many of them had managed to survive as long as they did. Thank you.
Paul.
There is no other lecture series like this at Westmont. We have many series where someone gives a talk followed by Q&A. In this one, someone gives a talk, a Westmont faculty, followed by criticisms of Westmont faculty. Criticism does not mean that you poke holes at what has been said. You rather analyze and interact. To introduce our two respondents, one of the incoming vice presidents. We will do so one at a time. Phoebe Wicks. Phoebe?
So our two faculty respondents tonight are Dr. Kaya Mangrum and Dr. Rachel Winslow. Dr. Mangrum, in her 2 years at Westmont as an assistant professor of English, she has taught broadly in American literature, including courses in the rhetoric of the Civil Rights Movement, historiography of American literature across cultures, and a course on slavery and the sea. She has held positions at the University of Utah and at Cornell University, and as a Mellon postdoctoral fellowship. Her groundbreaking book project, How Deep and Dark, Slavery, Photography, and the Limits of Narrative, examines how 19th century African Americans employ a variety of multimedia strategies to resist standard narratives of slavery and to expand readings of African American agency. Will they both be doing it at the same time? Or?
Why don't you introduce both?
And then Dr. Rachel Winslow, she is an associate professor of history here, director of Westmont Center of Social Entrepreneurship, and co-director of Westmont's Initiative for Public Dialogue. She is the author of The Best Possible Immigrants, International Adoption and the American Family, published in 2017. Dr. Winslow also serves as a fellow with the Kettering Foundation, working on the intersection between historical deliberation and civic participation as a way to engage students in democracy. Her teaching, research, and community work bring together her interests in U.S. social policy, social change practices, and American political culture in the 19th and 20th centuries. So, Dr. Mangrum and Dr. Winslow.
Thank you, everyone, for being here for Dr. Pointer's talk. Where are you, Dr. Pointer? Thank you, Dr. Pointer, for your talk.
Right here.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you. In his talk, Dr. Pointer identifies Yohannes Papanoff as a Christian, a preacher, and a peacemaker, a man who embraced nonviolent protest. We might, in this way, number Papanoff as an 18th century ancestor of Christian peacemakers like Ella Baker, the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King, and Brian Stevens, all of whom harness the power of peaceful protest. In what Dr. Pointer describes as, quote, an early America fraught with bloody violence and racial hatred, unquote, Papanoff embraces a peace that asserts that, quote, when God made men, he never intended that they should kill and destroy one another, unquote. The killing and destruction of God's people was not, according to Papanoff, God's purpose for mankind. By honoring the lives of all people, even those who sought to kill and destroy him, Papanoff honors God's creation and works to usher in God's kingdom here on earth. For Papanoff, the holiness of all living things, the image of God present in all human beings, required that one preserve life no matter the cost. And yet, Papanoff's beliefs and actions do not suggest that one should abstain from the pursuit of justice or avoid righteous struggle. On the contrary, Papanoff models for each of us a mode of resistance that honors the image of God in all people by seeking to maintain life while also simultaneously insisting on the shared and common humanity of native peoples and white settlers. Papanoff's peace is not the desire for a false peace, where he and his followers do not enjoy full human dignity and the pursuit of liberty. Rather, Papanoff's work as a diplomat, preacher, and thinker testified to the various and imaginative approaches he takes to peacefully seek justice for his people. Although, as Dr. Pointer notes, Papanoff, quote, was never willing to give up his opposition to war and more broadly violence, he did not want his followers taking up the sword, no matter what it might cost him, close quote. Papanoff's willingness to sacrifice his life to maintain his beliefs is a means of self-actualization. In order to manifest his identity as a man who loves God and a man who loves others, Papanoff develops a strong Christian faith, one that leads him to believe that, with God helping him, he can keep his people safe without taking up the sword. So I have no criticisms for Dr. Pointer's talk. I have a question, right? What does it look like to affirm God's image, no matter the cost? So reading Dr. Pointer's essay and hearing his lecture, I started to think of another 18th century thinker, another person in the intellectual history of Native thinkers, Sam Occam. And I mentioned him a little earlier. Samuel Occam was born in 1723 and died in 1792. He was a contemporary of Papanoff. He was a minister in the Presbyterian Church, one of the first Native ministers to earn ordination. He was Mohican from Connecticut. He was a popular preacher and teacher and toured England to raise money for a New England Christian school to train Indian ministers. And it so happens that the money he raised for that school was misappropriated by a man named Eleazar Wheelock. Eleazar Wheelock took the school that was going to be used to train Indian ministers and created Dartmouth. yeah, so that happened. And this is from Dartmouth's website concerning this issue. Eleazar Wheelock originally stated his intention to open a school to convert Native Americans to Christianity, and Eliezer Bilak was a European settler. His reasons were primarily because he literally feared for their souls, but also because he thought this mission would address the conflicts between Europeans and Native Americans. He eventually abandoned this goal in a pragmatic pursuit of financial gain and prestige. So I found like a very interesting network where Sam Oakham, who Henry Louis Gates described as like one of the most popular men of the 18th century Atlantic, along with one of the most popular women of the 18th century Atlantic, Phyllis Wheatley. So they exchanged a series of letters with each other. And Sam Oakham, when he was touring in Europe, he was hosted by George Whitefield while he was in London. So via the Whitefield, Wheelock's the dude who took the money and made Dartmouth, right? Via the Whitefield Wheelock connection, the Whitfields, and the Wheelocks knew the Wheatleys. Okay. I didn't realize that was going to be so hard. knew the Wheatleys. The Wheatleys of Boston owned an enslaved child named Phyllis. She was named after the slave ship that brought her. And we have lost the letter that he wrote to Phyllis, but we have the letter that Phyllis wrote to him. And I want to tell you a little bit about Phyllis before I quote from the letter that she wrote to Oakham. Sam Oakham was a preacher, very popular. And Phyllis Wheatley was this precocious little girl who had read all of his sermons as they were being published. And she essentially learns how to speak English. She was brought over on the slave ship when she was about 7 or 8 years old. Very sickly, very small. And Phyllis was able to teach herself how to speak English and write and read in English within 4 years. By the time she's 11, 12, 13, she's reading the classics and writing poetry. And this precocious young kid writes too. Oakham. And in her letter to Oakham, she shows me what I think is a really poignant example of Christians talking to each other across difference. So in Oakham's sermon, he writes against slavery, and Phyllis responds in this way, agreeing with his arguments against slavery, and also hoping for freedom and liberty for Samson Oakham and his people. And this is what Phyllis says. For in every human breast, God has implanted a principle which we call love of freedom. It is impatient of oppression and pants for deliverance. So I think I want to just kind of end by thinking about what are some creative modes of peaceful, prophetic protest that we see in both Oakham and Papanek and Wheatley. And I just want to, I think, maybe raise the question to you, Dr. Poynter. Do we see similar modes of peaceful protest among Europeans in the French Indian Wars, or okay, thank you.
So I'm a U.S. historian who focuses predominantly on the late 19th and 20th centuries. An era so recent that one of my medievalist friends in graduate school teased me that it's more accurate to call me a journalist than a historian. She would often comment enviously, "You have so many sources, so many records to choose from when you're building your argument." And of course, this was said as she was struggling to locate this one Hebrew text to excavate the 14th century Jewish community in Paris and write an article fully based around one source. And indeed, she's right. One of my largest concerns in reconstructing the past is sifting through boxes and boxes of relevant sources, trying to figure out what is the most essential to include. So in similar ways to my medievalist colleague, early Americanists like Dr. Poynter must also reconstruct the past with an extremely limited body of sources. Excavating the life of an average 18th century American is no small feat, requiring a fastidious dedication to combing through the texts and records of elites to pull out fragments of memories and interactions, all from the perspectives of those with political and social authority, and particular ways of viewing their worlds. Even when historians are fortunate and find primary sources from the perspectives of ordinary people, such as the case with Papenhuyt's diary, for instance, there are time-bound conventions of record keeping, think Twitter feed versus a blog post, right, that can leave the modern reader with more questions than answers. Historian Laurel Thatcher Ulrich wrote an award-winning book about a 17th century midwife named Martha Ballard, based almost entirely off of her sparsely written diary. Ulrich explains the research process this way. "My connection to the past," she writes, "like any historian's, is through the stuff that's left behind. It's not an imaginative connection, although imagination is part of it. It's about documents, it's about sources, it's about clues, it's about the leavings, the shards, the remnants of people who once lived. Without documents, there are no histories. Reconstructing those shards is much, much harder for those who served as social outsiders because of their gender, race, religion, or class than it is for those who had social privilege and the opportunity to leave copious records behind. So historians must not only read the hidden transcripts, in the words of anthropologist James Scott, to weigh the meaning of what is left unsaid, but they also must rely on non-textual sources, such as visual images and material culture. This is one reason why a great imbalance persists in our treatment of historical figures. There's simply significantly more material to recreate the world of Benjamin Franklin than Papunek. Given this intense time investment, why does it matter that historians devote themselves to recreating the worlds of figures like Papunek and Martha Ballard? I would argue that it is about far more than simple corrective representation or adding more perspectives. Just like in our larger cultural conversations about diversity, we don't need different people sitting at the table because it looks good, or signals that we care about diversity, or means we include more people. We need different people sitting at the table because it fundamentally changes what we know and how we will act moving forward because of that knowledge. It destabilizes who exercises authority and how power is distributed. Along the same lines, widening the historical record isn't about just giving us more histories to know. Instead, it reframes our perspectives on what we thought was true and leads us to discrete interpretive conclusions. It revises our canons, it remaps our power relations. So research like Dr. Poynter's offers a necessary interruption to the dominant narratives that continue to circulate in our cultural mythology. Through the lens of Papunek's life, Poynter not only dispels the notion of widespread violent resistance among American Indian groups, but also teases out the different strains of pacifism and peacekeeping launched out of the 18th century Moravian context. Papunek's story is particularly refreshing because it reveals how a Native American leader shaped the thought and actions of white Pennsylvanians in his sphere of influence. As an influencer, Papunek's life also gives us a better sense of what kinds of methods pacifists would employ in 18th century North America. Papunek first pursued neutrality during the Seven Years' War, and then when this strategy became untenable, his next move was to lead his people out of the battle zone to prevent retaliations. These decisions and future tactics were not made in a vacuum. Papunek drew on inspiration of past leaders, including Tecumseh in the 17th century, who used diplomatic, political and legal channels to pursue reciprocity and relationship building as an alternative to violence. Papunek's adaptation of the Iroquois tradition of grievance ceremonies highlights the value of both parties acknowledging the sacrifices made and the accompanying emotional cost before attempting to solve a problem that's set before them. As Dr. Poynter so aptly writes in his paper, emotional power then could combine with moral power and spiritual might to heal broken relations. This approach is a sophisticated and holistic conflict resolution technique, one that in fact we can still see vestiges of in recent restorative justice and arbitration work. The account of Papunik demonstrates the multi-layered and intentional work that goes into peacekeeping. Equating peace with simple neutrality or removal from conflict fails to capture the many stages that comprise a consistent and substantial alternative to violence. Nor does it show how peacekeeping will feel offensive to those interested in maintaining power, because it's easy to justify violence when faced with injustice. As Papunik's life demonstrates, though, it's much harder to offer an alternative vision for reconciliation. In William Faulkner's 1951 novel, Requiem for a Nun, he famously observed that the past is never dead, it is not even past. As Faulkner's insight suggests, although Papunik lived over 300 years ago, his life's work can animate our conversations and questions for how peace might be realized in the 21st century. To what extent do we account for emotional and moral power when healing broken diplomatic and political relations in our present era? How can we normalize the process of reconciliation as one in which both parties will face grief? What will we need to give up to learn to listen to across the boundaries of our increasingly polarized communities? Models of past peacemakers can give us the imagination and courage to pursue peace in our contemporary context, and that is why it is crucial that historians continue to tell the stories of social and political outsiders like Papunik, whose countercultural legacy offers us hope and potential strategies for future peace.
I'd like to invite Dr. Poynter to come up and field questions that you might have. I hope Professors Nelson and Ree will continue the tradition that we've established at Phi Kappa Phi, and that is the very first question must come from a student.
While you're thinking of one, let me just thank my colleagues for those lovely comments and examples and reflections, way more articulate than I've been tonight. So thank you for taking my story seriously. Well, I'm good if you're good.
There's often an awkward pause.
Yes, now I think we've moved on from awkward. Yeah. I feel like I'm waiting for a bid, you know, an auctioneer. So. Do I hear 5 cents? Dr. Mollenpolli.
I'm a lifelong learner.
Please. Yeah, almost impossible to answer that. In fact, you know, one of the things I'd want to reiterate about what I covered tonight was the fact that almost all the examples and quotes that I gave from him were from his pre-Christian period, okay? So I don't want to leave the impression that even all of this, well, I'll just call it God talk, is post-Christian, it is pre-Christian. Now, of course, it's being translated and passed along in most cases by people of Christian faith. And so what they heard and wrote down may or may not have been exactly what he had in mind. Probably the most powerful passage in one sense, or most important, is the narrative of this vision quest that goes for about 2 pages. And he tells that story to a Quaker on his way from Philadelphia up to Bethlehem, Pennsylvania. Then we eventually get it, not from that Quaker, but The Quaker himself was getting it at the time through an Indian interpreter. And then that Quaker passed it on to another Quaker or two or a committee who eventually published it. So I talk about it as a fourth-hand account. And in many cases, we would discount such a sort of redacted, presumably redacted kind of document. But I think there are really good reasons to believe it's a quite faithful representation, and I won't try to explain that. But, you know, as wonderful as the Moravian diaries and letters are, the snippets we get of native, and specifically his theology, let's say, or expressions of Christian faith, are not surprisingly very much echoes of Moravian emphases. So just to give you one example, because it's mostly unfamiliar to the vast majority of us, in this period from the 1740s to the 60s, Moravian theology was very strongly oriented towards the sacrifice of Jesus. So it's actually described by theologians and historians as a blood and wounds theology. It was extremely sensual. They put a lot of emphasis on the side wound of Jesus. And frankly, as you kind of read accounts of it, you might think it's at the very least unusual, if not odd. But this is clearly the message that they were preaching to their native listeners. And it very much resonated within most native cultures, but especially those we call Eastern Woodland Indians. Blood was such an important and powerful cultural entity, you might say, cultural symbol. And so to talk and emphasize blood was very much a message that was going to ring true with these native peoples. And so that, I think, is one of the reasons why Moravians were more successful, if that's the right way to put it, in their evangelization of native peoples than, I would argue, any other, at least Protestant group within early America. And they formed these communities where you have usually two German-Moravian couples, and everyone else in that community is a native person. So these are native towns, these are native villages, living according to native ways, even with the Moravians encouraging them in certain kinds of ways. And yeah, that's a long answer to your quick question. Paul?
So he has this vision when he's 45 years old.
Roughly, yeah.
And in one of his quotes, he said something about ceasing from war or fighting. Mm-hmm. And do you assume that he was active as a warrior before his vision quest?
I do. It's inferred, implied. I have no evidence that he was. But the reality is that every native community would have trained men in warfare, thought of them as warriors when the occasion demanded it. And my guess, given all the conflicts that went on in the 1740s especially, there's a very good chance. The vision quest, it was fairly unusual for an adult to go on a vision quest. We associate that as a rite of passage for young Indian male teenagers usually. Usually you went off for 3 or 4 days having imbibed some essentially hallucinogenic liquid, that the hope was you would have an encounter, a vision with your Manitou, it's called, your own sort of guardian spirit. So for an adult to do it, it's clearly a crisis moment for him. His father has died. He tells us that. There's good reason to think that he had abused alcohol for a portion of his life. He leaves in a very depressed state, and he comes back, as he tells the story, a transformed man. On the fifth day, He sees supernatural being. He tells us that that supernatural being reveals things about how to heal. So special knowledge about herbs and plants and the like. But he comes back, and from all evidence we have, his life has been transformed. And I suggest that he begins to tell people his story, what's happened to him. And pretty soon that telling of the story bleeds into what I would call exhortation, you know, preaching. And then people begin to follow him. And he's forming his own community, as other Indian prophets at this same time did. Now, again, I get going. Sorry, Ed.
Thanks for your presentation. You mentioned that
I guess I can
one
leave
of the areas of North American thought, 17th, 18th century, that's been neglected is that of Native Americans. And I'm wondering if you could situate the point within the broader context of that thought. Are there elements of pacifism within it that he's tapping into? And obviously, beyond his encounter with the Moravian Christians, are there other sources for him or for others in that thing?
Right, right. Yeah, so if I had read more of the examples from other Indian peoples, you'd have a better sense that I do see him inheriting in some way. Now, I don't think, you know, he's not literate. We know he could speak in several languages, but we have no evidence that he could read or write. So this would be oral traditions within his own people group about the one example that Rachel mentioned in her remarks, Takapusha, that I described from the 17th century. And so when we talk about an intellectual tradition there, I think we have to sort of give up sort of our traditional notions that that's passed down through written texts only, rather than a set of ideas. Now, I think where he stands out is in embracing what I've called an ideological pacifism, not just what I would also label a kind of pragmatic pacifism, where some Indian leaders decided, probably after a lot of trial and error, that peace was the only way to go. And diplomacy was the only option. And of course, that took many, many different forms. One of the major ones is land sales. Sometimes we have the notion that Europeans came and just sort of rode roughshod over Indian peoples. Most of the land that they get is actually through land sales. Now, the pressures and forces that are bringing that about are not always so humane, we'll say. Yeah. And then, you know, actually the person that Kaya's comments referred to, Samson Ockham, sometimes he, to the extent we have anthologies trying to trace American Indian intellectual traditions, he'll be the first person in that anthology because we have sermons from him and we have letters. And we begin by the mid-18th century to have a collection of native persons who are writing more intentional, well, writing, first of all, and then more intentionally reflective things. Yeah. Okay. Last one, or are we done, Russ?
We like to close this at 8:30. We're just a little over, but what I'd like to do, I have one announcement to make after we finish. But I'd like to give you, if you take just a couple of minutes, if you'd like to respond either to any of the issues that either Professor Mangrum or Winslow raised.
Well, you know, I think the only thing I would say in terms of Dr. Mangrum's comments would be that, I think it would be really healthy for us to mine these modes of protest that we find. Certainly, you mentioned some from the 20th century, but also from the 18th century, and in some way that bridges exactly with where Dr. Winslow ended up, that part of what I've taken away from these long years of working on this project, and it's also what some who've read the manuscript have taken away, is that in some hopefully significant way, when the 5 or 10 people actually read this book, they will be prompted to say, well, there is something here for our moment. And, you know, not all historical learning and writing needs to have some kind of contemporary relevance. But I would say that for myself, I'm not quite a pacifist, but my concern for being a person that lives like that has grown greatly. Yeah. So thanks, everyone.
Just a quick announcement. This whole setup was made possible by the Gating Institute, and I'd like to thank Aaron Sizer for arranging the video and everything, or the recording and the screen and the projectors, and also the refreshments that you're invited to partake of as you further the conversation tonight. For those of you who are students, the Gating Institute is actually named after a person, and that person is here, Stan Gating. If you just stand. And so you're invited to hang around. Let's thank all of our speakers one more time.
Thank you.
That was wonderful.
Thank you for being here.